All right, so let me review this off-axis emission, because we did the on-axis emission. That was easy. The correct way to look at it is with the off-axis emission, because when we do a curved axis approximation, when we do the curved arc, there's only one place, which is right there, where the electron is going directly at the observer. And the rest of the time, it's off at an angle alpha, so you have to deal with it. All right, so again, from A to B, you get emission of a pulse of light, which travels a distance C times delta T prime, while in the direction, remember this is exaggerated, so the arc is very shallow, and I'm far away. My observer is far away, I just can't draw it that way. So what you see is a motion of the electron, and the position of the source is really V times cosine alpha delta T. That's how far the electron moves towards the observer in the projection perpendicular to the observer. The light pulse still travels C delta T prime. And so your difference is a C minus V cosine alpha delta T prime. And that then becomes the wavelength, or the time, the period of the pulse of radiation between the two pulses. So the observer measures the time between two pulses, which is delta T, which is C minus V cosine alpha, delta T prime over C. And that can be rewritten in terms of, well, I'll just rewrite it here. Just, it becomes 1 minus V over C cosine alpha, delta T prime, and then, of course, 1 minus beta. So you rewrite it in terms of the beta parameter, 1 minus beta cosine alpha. And this is actually the important equation right here, this part here. Now what we can do is we can look at what the Doppler shift is when you're off-axis, which depends on the angle alpha, right? So it's coming directly at you at one point, but then it's deviating on the other side. Since alpha is very small, we can make the approximation cosine alpha is 1 over alpha squared over 2. And since gamma is very large, we can make its approximation as 1 minus we can use the approximation of 1 minus 1 over 2 gamma squared for the cosine, for the beta, rather. And when you multiply these and throw away everything that's fourth order small, this is second order small, and this is fourth order small, then we get a very simple relation for the pulse compression. This is the pulse compression, so that the pulse separation, the pulse timing that the observer sees divided by the pulse timing that the electron emits is alpha squared over 2, that's already small, plus 1 over gamma squared, 2 gamma squared, which is also small. So it's two very small numbers. And when you rewrite this by putting them over a common denominator, you get 1 plus alpha squared gamma squared over 2 gamma squared. So if you think about this as order 1, and this being small and this being large also being order 1. So these things on the top are order 1. And this is large, right? 1 over gamma squared. So basically this dominates everything. And I could just ignore this and write it as 1 over 2 gamma squared. So I'm going to write that down because we're going to use it later. So I'm going to say that delta T over delta T prime is approximately, even more approximately, well, let me just write it 1 plus alpha squared gamma squared over 2 gamma squared. But this is approximately 2 over 2 gamma squared or 1 over gamma squared, one of those two. You can do 1 over gamma squared, 2 gamma squared. It doesn't really matter. It's going to be something on that order. Right? Remember, we're doing this very approximately. That's the time compression ratio, which we're going to use. Now, if I now plot I have times, I want to convert them to frequencies, right? So if I consider this as a period, then the frequency is the inverse of that. So delta T gives me 1 over F. Delta T prime, 1 over delta T prime gives me F prime. And so if I want to look at the Doppler shift, which is the frequency observed by the person in the laboratory compared to the frequency emitted by the electron as it goes through these segmented bends, right, because we're considering a segmented bend, then that just becomes F over F prime, but that becomes delta T prime over T. So I have to flip that around. Now it's 2 gamma squared over 1 plus alpha squared gamma squared. Now, if I plot that, this F over F prime, it's a highly peaked, well, and I have to use a gamma, right? So I have to figure out what is gamma and what is alpha. Well, alpha is here. It's in radians. And gamma is a constant, depending on the storage ring. So for the advanced photon source, it's on the order of 14,000. For NSLS, it's about 3,000. Right? So when I plot these two functions, I can see that the frequency compression, or the Doppler shift, effectively the Doppler shift, is between 10 to the 8th and 10 to the 9th. For the advanced photon source, it's somewhere above 10 to the 7th for the NSLS. So whatever that frequency is, you Doppler shift it up by that ratio. All right, so the Doppler shift is in the blue region. That means it goes to higher energies, which is what we expect. But you can also see from this figure how the dependence on alpha works, right? If you're right on the axis, you have the highest Doppler shift, and you see the highest energies right on axis. As soon as you move off axis, and what I mean by off axis is above and below, because we're talking about, or even to the sides, you get lower energies. Actually, to the sides. This is to the sides. So you get lower energies. As I move away from the axis like this and this, I'm going to see lower energies. And the energies drop really quite quickly. So these lines that I've drawn, these intersections of the horizontal and vertical lines, are where alpha, the angle, is the opening angle. 1 over gamma is the opening angle of the radiation. Remember, the opening angle of the radiation depends on 1 over gamma. So that's where this beam comes out, the most of the beam. So you can see that the 1 over gamma is really only the tip of this peak. And then, and you actually can't see any further out, because if you go too far out, you're going to be blocked by slits and things like that. So practically, you only have a 1 over gamma. And where F over F prime is 1/2 of its maximum value. Right? So this is sort of the spectrum that you expect to see, right? Between there and there. That's the sort of the frequency spectrum you expect to see, a frequency amplification you expect to see on either side of angle. The highest energy emitted, of course, is within a cone of half angle 1 over gamma. And that's the way it looks here. So this is just sort of useful to visualize what the spectrum is going to look like, or the frequencies are going to look like. But we really haven't calculated anything except for this delta T over T, which is a very rough way of doing it. When we talk about segmented arc, we're making an approximation, and it's not the right approximation.